There are too many people today that are making too many excuses for why they're living a life of sin. So this morning, I wanted to take time to try to give you a more clear and definite scriptural lesson on what the scriptures say about the Christian life, the real Christian life.
Welcome to Somebody Loves You Radio, the Bible teaching ministry of Roll Reese in Diamond Bar, California. Well, on today's program, we're continuing our focus on fully surrendering to God and not persisting in sin and carnality, but living a Spirit-led life. Today, Roll will encourage us to take an honest look at the state of our hearts. If we claim to follow Jesus but habitually disobey God's Word, we'll see that this is a very dangerous place to be. Today's message is titled, The Christian Life. Here's Raul Reese.
Let me begin by reading chapter 6 of 1 Corinthians, beginning with verse 9. As Paul the Apostle is talking to the church of Corinth. And I told you in the past times that the church of Corinth was a very carnal church. These people were actually being not only exhorted, but rebuked by Paul the Apostle because they had a problem where they were communicating one thing about their relationship with God, but when it came to practice, they were not practicing what they preached. I feel that this is the place and this is the cause today among Christians. I feel that there's a lot of confusion where many people don't understand theologically what we really should believe about the Bible. And of course, our seminaries are creating more and more liberal theologians which don't believe in inspiration or revelation of the Bible. And so I think it's important and wise for us to really not only hit up the scriptures, but to see in common language what God has to say to someone that has accepted Christ, but at the same time, he's not living a life under the power of the Holy Spirit. How free am I really to do what I want to do in Christ Jesus? Listen to what Paul says, beginning with verse 9 of chapter 6. He says, don't you know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And then he says this important thing in verse 11. And such were some of you. You know, see, he clears it up to let you know that he's talking about your past life, whatever you were. This is what you used to be, and these are the things you used to practice as a non-believer. And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. And then verse 12, very quickly. All things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful or profitable. All things are lawful for me, but I, Paul says, will not be brought under the power of anything. You see, Paul wants to make sure that he's clear concerning Christian liberty. Because there are too many people today that are making too many excuses for why they're living a life of sin. So this morning, I wanted to take time to try to give you a more clear and definite scriptural lesson on what the scriptures say about the Christian life, the real Christian life. The reason is because there are so many Christians today that are living a life that really is not changed life. And so when they call themselves Christians, it doesn't seem to match with what Jesus really taught in the scriptures. And Paul the Apostle has told us that we used to be like that, but we are no longer practicing such things. And if we are, then we need to check and see if we're really Christians, because we should not be in that position as believers. Listen to what Jesus says concerning some of these people. In the book of Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23, this is what Jesus said. He says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name?'" Hey, wait a minute. Here is Jesus himself in the Sermon on the Mount, and he's teaching disciples. And he's saying that on the day of judgment, when people stand there to be judged, he says, these people are going to stand there and they're going to speak forth and say, "Lord, don't you remember that I was prophesying in your name?" That means they had the gift of prophecy. That means, what the next thing that he says, "We also cast out demons in your name." They were doing exorcisms. And then he says, "Not only did we cast out demons in your name, but we have done many wonders in your name." Miracles and wonders were performed by some of these people that will not be in heaven. Now the reason is because of their lifestyle that they were living. This is what Jesus responds to this. "And then I will declare unto them," Jesus said, "I never knew you. Depart from me, you who continually practice sin." Pretty heavy. That's the words of Jesus. So it's not what Calvin said. It's not what Wesley said. It's not what Luther said concerning when you come to theology. It's what Christ has said in the scriptures. You see? Because so many people will come and say, "Well, aren't you in eternal security?" Yeah, I believe in eternal security. But I believe also in eternal security, that as long as I abide in Jesus Christ, I am safe. But if I am not abiding in Christ, then I am not safe. And this is something that, I mean, has been not only spoken about through the centuries, debated concerning true salvation and a non-essential of salvation. It's important that you understand that Paul and James, in writing their epistle, the Romans and the James, the actual brother of Christ, stepbrother of Christ who wrote the book of James, were not contradicting themselves as some theologians would say, because James talked about works and Paul talked about faith. But faith and works go together. And Paul and James were in agreement. He says, in order for a Christian to have true faith, there have to be true works. We're not saved by works. We're saved by faith in Jesus Christ, but true faith brings forth true works in Christ. There's a change of life. There's a change of heart. Listen to some of the scriptures that Paul brings about concerning, as he speaks not to non-believers, he's speaking to Christians. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9 through 11, he says this, "I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexual immoral people." Paul is not talking about non-believers. Listen very clearly what he says. "Yet I certainly did not mean with sexual immoral people of this world." He said, I'm not talking about the heathens. Again, he goes on. "I certainly do not mean the sexual immoral people of this world," he says, "or with covetous or extortioners or idolaters, since then you need to go out of the world. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone who is called a Christian." There it is. I want you to underline that. A brother, one that has come to the knowledge of Christ, that is continuing to live a life of sin. Paul is giving advice. Then he says this, "But I have written to you not to keep company with anyone who is named a brother, who is sexually immoral, covetous, an idolater, a reviler, a drunkard, an extortioner. No, don't even have dinner with them." Don't even eat with them. Why? Because what happens is you're actually saying it's okay to hang out with such people when they're bringing stumbling to those that do not know Christ. See? You'll bring confusion to people. Paul the Apostle, later on, he writes in that same epistle, and he says that what happens with such a person that is living a life of sin like that, has accepted Christ, he says, you turn them over to Satan for Satan to destroy their flesh so that at the end they might repent and they will have their spirit saved. Otherwise, they perish. So important that we understand we cannot support people living in sin. Now, that doesn't make us more righteous than they. Because we all fail, we all fall daily. But this is habitual practicing of sin openly. Saying, well, yeah, I go to Calvary Chapel, I go to the Baptist Church, or the Methodist, or Lutheran Church. And yet at work they know that you're living together with your girlfriend. How can that be when the Bible says it's sin? Or you go after work and you get drunk with everyone at work. And then you say you're a Christian. Paul is talking about you and I bringing confusion and living a double standard life, becoming hypocrites in the kingdom of God. As a matter of fact, in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 to 21, speaking to Christians again, Paul says, now the works of the flesh are evident, which are these. What are the works of the flesh? Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery. The word sorcery there in the Greek is pharmakia. It's the Greek word which get our English for drugs, not aspirin, okay? But drug addicts, taking drugs. Hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of anger, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murder, drunkenness, revilers, and like of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also have told you in times past, that those who are continuing to practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Underline that. He's talking to Christians, not non-believers.
This is Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Reese. Our goal is to help you pursue God's perfect plan for your life as you ground yourself in His Word. Visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165 for Bible-based resources, including Raul's book titled Man, Natural, Carnal, Spiritual. Now let's go back to the final part of our study, The Christian Life.
Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3 and 7, talking to Christians again. But fornicators and uncleanness and covetousness, let it not be named among you as it's fitting as Christians. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which is not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know, that no fornicator, no unclean person, no covetous man, no idolater who has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partaker with them. Notice what he says. He's talking to believers. You see, people today are making so many excuses for the things they are doing. Making excuses always. And are not taking the responsibility for their actions. That's a problem. Paul the Apostle, in writing again to the Corinthians, in chapter 6, verse 11, said this, and such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Let me take you back just a little bit in my study this morning on our past, present, and future. What Christ says scripturally. First of all, in our past life, we used to be very foolish people. The things that we did, when I look back at my past, I'm ashamed of it. Totally ashamed of it. Paul the Apostle said in 1 Corinthians 2:14, he says that at one time we were natural people. He says the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. Before we came to know Christ, church and Bible and everything else concerning the things of God were stupidity to us. We didn't believe in those things. We thought that was for only people that were crazy or weird. That when we came to Christ, no longer are we to be natural men like heathens and the way we used to be, without thinking, doing things, and without conviction. But now we have the Holy Spirit to convict us. We can't get away with it. We'll be miserable. And then secondly, Paul says that we should not forget that we were dead to sin. We were dead men, dead women, without Christ, without hope in this world. Ephesians chapter 2, 1 to 3 says this, "And you who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and the power of the air, the spirit that now is working in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all had our manner of life in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, just as others." You see, we used to be like that. And thirdly, we were Satan's children. Satan was your father and my father. And today, Satan is every person's father who doesn't know Christ. John 8:44 says this, "You are of your father," Jesus said, "the devil." And it says, "And the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When Satan speaks, he lies, and he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of all lies." You see? This is the kind of situation we find ourselves in the world with. People that don't know Christ. Fourthly, we were the children of wrath. The wrath of God was upon our lives. In Romans 1:18, he says, "For the wrath of God is revealed or unveiled from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who are suppressing the truth in unrighteousness." You see? Children of wrath. Fifthly, we were the actual living a life of the flesh without conviction, without God. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 to 20, he says, "For I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the desires of the flesh. For the flesh is lusting against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are at war with one another, contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are what? Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, drugs, hatred, contention, jealousies, outburst of anger, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies. All these are the works of the flesh." And six, we were in darkness, total darkness without the light. This is why Jesus in John 8:12 said this, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk any longer in darkness, but shall have the light of life." The light has been turned on when we came to Christ. Totally different. And seventh and lastly, concerning the old man or the old nature, is this, that we were walking in the flesh. We gave to it. Romans 8, 1 and 4 says this, "Therefore, now there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ, who are not walking according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who are not walking according to the flesh, but according to the Holy Spirit." You see, the second point is this, that we have received a new life. New life. How did that come about? Well, it came about through the new birth. That is, it wasn't through infant baptism. It wasn't through your first communion. It wasn't through any of the seven sacraments that you need to keep, but it was actually supernaturally. It wasn't inherited through your grandma, through your grandfather, or mother, or father, or brother, or sister. It came about when the Holy Spirit supernaturally came to you and convicted you of your sins. And then you submitted yourself to God, to coming to repentance and asking Christ to come into your life. There was a Jewish rabbi by the name of Nicodemus at the time of Christ. that not only was bothered, but he kept sneaking out by night because he wanted to find the answers to his questions. And when he came to Jesus one night, he said, "Jesus, what must I do, Master, to be born again or to inherit eternal life?" And this is what Jesus said to him. Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, Nicodemus, unless one is born again, he will never or he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? How can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" He was thinking physically. Jesus was speaking spiritually, you see? And then Jesus came back with the answer and said this, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit." So he makes a distinction between your natural birth and your divine birth. Notice that. "Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again, or you'll never see God." That's what the scripture teaches. We must be born again. Secondly, the new birth, of course, comes through the conviction and the working of the Holy Spirit within my life. Listen to what Jesus said in John 16, 7 through 10. "Nevertheless, let me tell you the truth," he said. "It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I don't go away, the helper," or literally in the Greek, the paracletus, the comforter, the Holy Spirit, "will not come to you. But if I die and rise again, if I depart, then I will send him to you. And he, when he has come, he will convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. And of judgment, because the prince of this world already has been judged, Satan." So you see, it is the work of the Holy Spirit to convict a person. No one in this building, no one outside of this building, can ever come to Christ unless it is the work of the Holy Spirit. You can have your relatives take you down to the church and have you baptized, take communion, go through all the rituals. It doesn't make you a Christian. It has to be done by God's Holy Spirit. And then when God brings us to this conviction, then we desire and we know that we have received this new life through the grace of God. It's all of God's grace, not of works, lest any man should boast. Listen to Paul in Ephesians 2:8. "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it's not of yourselves, it is the gift of God," you see? It is the gift of God for you and I when we receive salvation. Fourthly, it is through God's love. In John 3:16 it says what? "That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe it on him should not perish but have everlasting life." Then in Romans chapter 5 verse 8, Paul says, "But God demonstrated his own love towards us, in that while you and I were still yet sinners, Christ died for us." That's true love. Jesus Christ demonstrated his love when he went to Calvary to die for you and me.
We hope today's lesson has provided helpful clarity about what it looks like to follow Jesus as a true believer, not in name only, but in your attitudes and actions. You're listening to Somebody Loves You Radio with Roel Reese. Today's message is titled "The Christian Life." An unedited copy is available to you for a donation of $5 or more. To get your copy, just call us at 800-634-9165. We'd also like to offer you Rawls' book titled "Man, Natural, Carnal, Spiritual." This resource will guide you into how to live the fruitful life God desires for you as you serve Him with your heart, mind, soul, and strength. You'll see that when you make a true commitment to the Lord, He'll fill you with His Holy Spirit and use your life for His purposes. To order Rawl's book titled Man, Natural, Carnal, Spiritual, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165. We'll send your copy for $8 plus shipping and handling. The number again is 800-634-9165. Or you can write us at Somebody Loves You Radio, P.O. Box 4440, Diamond Bar, California, 91765. If you find yourself listening to this program on a radio station and you aren't able to hear the entire study, there's an easy solution. It's the Somebody Loves You Radio podcast. Whether you get your podcast through iTunes or Spotify, this convenient platform brings Rawl's teaching to you on your schedule. Thank you for your partnership. You're a great blessing to us, and every contribution is tax deductible. Join us next time as we continue the study of the differences between a natural, carnal, and spiritual person. You'll get a challenge to examine your priorities and evaluate the place God has in your daily life.
I am falling in love with you.
This program is sponsored by Somebody Loves You Radio in Diamond Bar, California.